by each of the two groups of members, that is, those returned by FCs and those returned by GCs through the who are present, I declare the motion passed. Mr. Andrew Leung, according to Rule 49E2 of the Rules of Procedure, to take note of mandatory provisions, schemes, amendment, ordinance 2015, commencement notice 2015, which was included in report number 23-1415 of the House Committee lay on the table of this Council. According to relevant debating procedure, I will first call upon Andrew Leung to speak and move the motion, and then call upon the chairman of the subcommittee forum to scrutinize the item, Mr. Chung Kwok-pan, to speak, to be followed by other members. Each member may only, including the mover of the motion, may only speak once and may speak for up to 15 minutes. Finally, I will call upon the public officer to speak. The debate will come to a close after the public officer has spoken, and the motion would not be put to vote. Members who wish to speak on the motion, please press the request to speak button. Mr. Andrew Leung, please speak and move the motion. As the chairman of the House Committee, according to ROP 49E of the Rules of Procedure, I move the motion on the agenda to enable the subcommittee to study report 23-1415, in particular, the Mandatory Provident Fund Scheme Amendment Ordinance 2015, Commencement Notice 2015, to enable members to engage in debate. I now put a question to you, and that is Mr. Andrew Leung's motion be passed. Mr. Chung Kwok-pan. Mr. President, in the capacity of the chairman of the subcommittee on the Mandatory Provident Fund Schemes Amendment Ordinance 2015, Commencement Notice 2015, I report to the Council the deliberations of our subcommittee. We had one meeting with the administration to study the relevant matters and completed our work. The purpose of the notice is to appoint the 1st of August 2015 as the commencement date for certain provisions of the Mandatory Provident Fund Schemes Amendment Ordinance. The provisions cover mainly the following items: A, allowing early withdrawal of MPF accrued benefits on terminal illness ground; B, clarifying the terms in respect of early withdrawal of MPF accrued benefits; C, simplifying the process for making withdrawal of MPF accrued benefits on the ground of total capacity; and D, reducing the compliance burden on trustees and employers by simplifying operational processes and communication. The subcommittee has no objection to the notice. Members hope that through reducing the burden of compliance on the trustees and employers, the fees on MPFs could be reduced. Members also noted that early withdrawal on the ground of terminal illness is allowed, and the member who has member of the MPF who have withdrawn the fund on such a ground, who later join the MPF after rehabilitation, will not be held legally liable, but if they make any false declaration, they will have to show their legal liability. The members also asked the administration to make take extra effort in publicizing the various changes and proposals. The members urge the administration to work with the MPFA and make use of different channels and communicate with the members of the MPFs and also employers so that they fully understand the new provisions and the changes. As for the new arrangement for early withdrawal on the ground of terminal illness, some members propose that there should be a simple pamphlet so that grassroots people can understand the arrangement, and the arrangement should be made so that doctors and medical social workers are fully aware of these schemes. The administration has and the MPFA have given undertaking that it will step up publicity with the medical practitioners, patients groups, social workers, insurance agents, and MPF intermediaries about the new arrangement, and they will print pamphlets and they will give the pamphlets to members per perusal. There will be no amendment to the commencement. Mr. President, this early withdrawal of accrued benefits is something that can be supported. are worth supporting. Anybody who has suffered from a terminal illness would require a lot of money to pay for the medical bill, and also to pay the medical bill or even to deal with their funerals. They need a lot of money. The MPF is to provide retirement protection. As for a patient suffering from terminal illness, retirement life is not quite relevant. As for the early withdrawal of accrued benefits, the money will help the patient to make future arrangements. We know that a person suffering from terminal illness will have to get certification from a doctor that the patient will have a lifespan of less than 12 months. With the progress of medicine, maybe before 12 months, the patient may be given, may be able to obtain a new treatment and then be able to recover. We care for those who suffer from terminal illness. We hope that the restrictions will not be too harsh. As for publicity, I hope among the healthcare sector there should be better publicity. When a patient suffering from terminal illness, the patient should be informed that they have the possibility of early withdrawal of accrued benefits from the MPFs. Just like somebody who has got a medical insurance, the healthcare profession can even assist by giving a form to the patient so that the patient can claim insurance. I think patients should be given the help. Thank you.
Also,
Ms. Ho. Thank you, Mr. President. Just now, Mr. Chung Kwok-pan talked about a particular member, which is me. This subsidiary legislation is a notice about the commencement date of early withdrawal. The nature of the proposal is not controversial because the intention is for a member to withdraw early the accrued benefit, and that itself has been enacted in another piece of legislation. This is related only to the commencement date. I still would like to have a subcommittee set up in order to ask the administration how they publicize this proposal to workers. I was concerned that they would use convoluted language to just set out the provision in law that is incomprehensible. It's just like a term that is called incapacitated person. So don't let alone blue collar, and any Hong Kong person hearing the term mentally incapacitated is margin to them. And in this subsidiary legislation, there is a similar term, which is total incapacity, which is the loss of a capacity to work. These can be converted into layman terms to facilitate understanding. So apart from letting employees who have a higher education to know about this, they should reduce it to easily understood language, or perhaps leaflets or some diagrams or cartoons to facilitate understanding among grassroots. We're talking about a new policy, a new initiative that will commence, and that would apply to most people in Hong Kong. It is most suitable to be publicized in API. However, in recent days, we see APIs of take it first, don't take things away, and the constitutional reform. They have filled APIs with these advertisements. But when it comes to proposals that benefit people's livelihood and are very much related to people's lives, there is very little publicity. Now, that the constitutional reform has come to an end and the government said they would focus on livelihood issues again, please use the API in prime time to let Hong Kong people know about this arrangement. Apart from the electronic form or publications, there are a lot of stakeholders involved. Say, for example, those who are terminally ill may have contact with the public, public hospitals, private hospitals, Chinese medicine practitioners, medical, social workers, the insurance sector. The government can conduct a large-scale publicity campaign to reach out to as many terminally ill as possible, or those who will have contact with terminally ill so that they can pass on the message. For someone who only has maybe 12 months left in his life, that person will have a lot of things to think about. They may not be aware that they have an amount of money sitting in an MPF account that can be withdrawn early to help them. So publicity is very important. Lastly, I will have to speak for employees because they have to wait till they only have 12 months of life left before they can withdraw the money. So the terms are quite harsh. But when it comes to employers, they can offset the MPF contribution against severance pay. If they close their business, they can take the money out. Maybe it's because of poor management of the business on their own part. They can take the money out to offset against severance pay. So that is very imbalanced. And I want it on the record that when it comes to early withdrawal of accrued benefit for the scheme member, to tie the scheme member over difficult times, I ask the administration to adopt the same approach, to remind themselves of the principle of ensuring proper retirement life, to not allow offsetting against their severance pay. Because after several of these offsetting payments, there is very little left. So I asked the Secretary to change that part.
Mr. Tan Ka-piu. Now it has become a policy and we support the amendment. It's just about the amendment notice, or rather the commencement notice. Our concern is preparatory work. Issue is terminal illness. The patient is assessed to have only a lifespan of no more than 12 months. And the other condition for early withdrawal is total incapacity. Many workers and unions have told us that public sector hospital doctors refuse to give such a certification. The patient has to pay a lot of money to get a private practitioner to write a report in order to convince the public sector doctor. I hope that the hospital authority and also the social workers within the hospital authority can be fully informed of the policy. It is about terminal illness. It's also about the assessment of total incapacity. There should be better communication so that the doctors are courageous enough to make such an assessment and certification. Now, the judgment will not, the doctor will not be held responsible for the judgment. Say, if the unfortunate Wei Chenna is able to live beyond 12 months, maybe until the 13th month, or even has recovered, the rehabilitated patient will not be held liable. I hope this can be publicized. Now, say a worker may suffer from, suffered from a terminal illness, and in order to avoid dealing with estates, want to withdraw the benefits first. And they may also be able to pay some money to get a new treatment. The family members have many things to consider. If they have a misunderstanding that if a declaration is made, if money is obtained, and if one is able to recover, there may be a criminal liability. I hope the Bureau will clarify this point. At the subcommittee meeting, we had already clarify that there will be no criminal liability. I hope that in your publicity, in the community, and also with the medical groups and also trade unions, such points should be emphasized and clarified. Early withdrawal on terminal illness, of course, is unfortunate. Now, apart from the above, there are also a number of measures to reduce administrative costs of the MPFs. At the end of 2015, maybe in 2016, the administrative cost will be more than $10 billion. This is really a difficult question. I hope the Secretary will also address this point in respect of the rising administrative cost of the MPFs. I'm referring to the absolute number. How can you deal with that? The wage earners are quite ambivalent toward the towards the MPF because they don't trust the MPF, which can tie them over their twilight years.
Mr. Ip Kwok-him, first of all, I have to declare interest. I'm a non-executive director of the MPFA. The DAB supports this commencement notice such that the ordinance will take effect on the 1st of August this year. The LegCo passed the bill on the 21st of January 2015. Representing major and important amendments such that employees can in phases withdraw their accrued benefits. The terminally ill can also withdraw their contribution in advance. After the amendments are made, contributors can more flexibly withdraw their accrued benefits. For the terminally ill, with less than 12 months remaining in their life, can in advance withdraw their accrued benefits. The public and medical professionals have been consulted and objective definitions have been worked out so as to attain more effective implementation. The MPF scheme has been charging very high fees and charges. This has been criticized by many employees. Continuous report to streamline the operation of the MPFA is for certain the duty of the MPFA. After the semi-portability system was adopted, smaller scale and lower cost-effective schemes were launched. In the market, we now have over 400-odd funds or schemes for choice. Some had actually stopped operating. We would like to further reduce the number of schemes. As for scheme members of personal accounts,
they'll be able to consolidate their accounts so as to attain a more ideal situation and reduce fees. In 2016, the core fund will be launched as the default fund, such that in the long run, funds conducive to long-term retirement benefits can result. In the long run, fees and charges can be reduced. The NPFA is discussing all these with the industry. With these remarks, I support the notice. Thank you.
Mr. Leung Yiu-chung, as some members have said that the legislation and the policy have already been discussed, and this piece of subsidiary legislation is the commencement date. We're concerned with two things. First, after this comes into effect, whether scheme members can actually benefit. The second part is how scheme members can actually get what they are supposed to get. And we have talked about the publicity of the government. As some members have said, how can we make sure their scheme members or their family members will actually receive the message? We have told government officials that perhaps they can do more when it comes to staff at hospitals, because they come into direct contact with the parties in question. So they are the best people to let them know that there is such an arrangement. Government officials said that they will step up publicity and education for those working in hospitals so that the policy can actually benefit the targeted group. And there is another matter of concern. Doctors. Are doctors willing to issue a certificate stating that the scheme member may pass away in less than 12 months? As some members have said, when it comes to occupational injuries, or doctors are reluctant or sometimes refuse to issue certificates. We can't force them, but for employees, they think, well, I don't think I stand a chance and I won't have long. There is no appeal mechanism. The government will only accept that doctors are professionals and should be the only party that issues this certificate. So we really hope that doctors will not be too rigid in their approach when dealing with these cases. And of course, for scheme members, we want to cure them. We don't want them to die, but the policy actually wants them to die. But that should not be the attitude. And of course, we hope that the scheme member may recover. Say, for example, in a case of cancer. If there is a chance that the patient can receive better treatment, by all means. So this the approach should be on the lax side. Otherwise, the policy will serve no purpose. The accrued benefit will only help with the funeral expenses, help the family, and not benefit the scheme member, him or herself. And if the accrued benefit is for the use of the scheme member in this twilight years, of course, it should be made available for the scheme member to use to alleviate pain or improve the quality of life. I hope that the government will do some more. to tell healthcare workers about the objective of the policy, and if necessary, let scheme members withdraw the money as soon as possible. And on top of that, we see that in publicity and education, employees should be made to understand that they don't have to refrain from making a withdrawal simply because they don't want their family members to know, because the accrued benefit is for their own use. If it's not withdrawn, then it's wasted in a way. This perspective should be dealt with in a publicity and education campaign. Please avoid stigmatism. Yes, it's for people who only have less than a year's life to live, but I do hope that they will recover. Some people may think it's quite pessimistic. If I make a withdrawal, it means I'm going to die within a year. How can I tell my family members? So I hope the government will take this into account. In principle, we don't agree with this, because you wait till the scheme member is near the end of his life before you allow them early withdrawal. They are at a stage when they are in despair. So the money is more for the funeral expenses than for medical expenses. And I think it's a problem with the policy. If you allow them to make a withdrawal to apply for early withdrawal if they suffer from serious illness, that would be better. But if you're talking about a terminal illness, if you give them the money, it's a sign that you're going to die. So what good will come out of it? It's not positive enough, and you should send out positive vibes, not negative vibes. I don't know whether it's a rarity that it happens. You give someone an amount of money to tell them that you're going to die. What good will come out of it apart from using it on the funeral? So I ask the government to review the policy as soon as possible. When employees suffer from an illness and need some money, let them make an early withdrawal so that they can receive treatment as soon as possible. We should send out a positive message, not a negative one. And there are a lot of room for area for improvement in the MPF scheme, say for example the offsetting mechanism, illnesses, or for buying a flat for education purpose. Well, I hope that there should be a review as soon as possible. I so submit.
其他議員要發言。咁如果冇咧，發言完，議員嘅發言完畢啦。
Well, I will now ask Secretary for FST to speak. First of all, I'd like to thank the Subcommittee on MPF Scheme Amendment Ordinance 2015, Commencement Notice 2015, and the Chairman, Mr. Chung Kwok-pan, and members. On the 21st of January this year, the MPF Scheme Amendment Bill was endorsed. The bill seeks to amend the arrangements so that scheme members can, in a flexible way, make early withdrawal, and to reduce trustees' compliance burden, to provide greater scope for reduction of MPF fees, and also some technical amendments. Well, actually, the ordinance, some of it has come into operation on the 30th of January 2015. Some of the provisions will come into operation on the 1st of August 2015.
計劃成員提早
including allowing early withdrawal of MPF accrued benefits on terminal illness ground, repealing repetitive or unnecessary compliance documents such as the acceptance notice and membership certificates. The subcommittee supports the commencement notice. I know that members were mainly concerned about preparation and publicity before the implementation of related provisions. Apart from contacting trustees to formulate relevant guidelines and forms and upgrade computer systems, the NPFA has also contacted organizations of Chinese medicine practitioners and medical practitioners, invited all district councillors to co-organize district activities, and will organize MPF talks to introduce the new arrangements under the amendment ordinance. The MPFA will also, in July this year, launch targeted publicity and education activities, including providing information on its website, issuance of press releases, publishing articles in newspapers and journals, and distributing publicity leaflets to those who assist the terminally ill, such as social workers, MPF intermediaries, and insurance agents. We understand that simple, readable publicity leaflets can help scheme members to understand more easily the arrangement for receiving accrued benefits in future. As such, the MPFA is printing two different leaflets for distribution to medical professionals and scheme members. The MPFA will follow the subcommittee's request and pass the printed publicity leaflets to the subcommittee for reference. Thank you, Mr. President. In accordance with Rule 49(e)(9) of the Rules of Procedure, I will not put any question on the motion. Debate on